Sigmund Freud and Farah Muhammad is an evolution of God. Searching for the truth is a threat. Seems the closer we get to the truth, state troopers offense. Come out to silence you. My house in Malibu probably tapped, cause living next door to Demi Moore. Plus I'm black, plus I want vengeance for the poor who's attacked daily. Patriot Act never scared me. Jake in the Taurus, sticky in the Jarvis. Wait, got warrants, America's browning. 20 years from now, every town will be brown and Latin. An African look in Manhattan. I'ma tell you what I seen with my three eyes. Word to me, not a hoax back in 99. A spacecraft in the skyline. In LA in daytime, ask horse if I'm lying.
Every mother, every father, raise your sons and your daughters with respect and with honor. From the seed comes the fruit. It's an unbroken circle. All of life is universal, and we're all in the struggle. If I know one thing is true, we're not.
Evidence remains in debate. Documents of our own Air Force base. Additional terrestrial information. Other planets with life population. My observation. Scientists study pictures of a flying disc. Right on Earth, anthropologists.
Good afternoon from beautiful Rockland, Maine, on a great fall day. This is your host, Gary Wheeler, and you have entered the zone of highest strangeness, a place where the unbelievable is believed until proven otherwise. The theme song you just listened to is from a group named Naz and is called We Are Not Alone. And it's reported that the lead singer, Michael, had a UFO sighting in Los Angeles and wrote the song as a result of that sighting. I've been told we have a new listener out in St. Louis named Nancy. Welcome, Nancy. And I have inside info. We may get a call from her one of these days, which would be great. As usual, I will be taking phone calls. The number is 207-593-0013. Some of the show has pre-recorded messages, but I will break in when a call comes. So don't worry about calling when the audio is on. Just a few phone rules. Just use your first names only, both for yourself and anybody else you speak of. And when you're talking, also, you can be anonymous if you choose. Of course, no questionable language. Again, the number is 593-0013, area code 207. And as always, especially interested in callers who have had a UFO or other paranormal experience, or know of someone who has. But also interested in those people who have strong opinions for or against the whole concept of ETs visiting us. And also if you just have any kinds of questions you might have about ETs that I can try to answer for you, or UFO sightings. Again, a reminder about the crop circle season is in full tilt in Britain. The best place to go and view these on the internet. Again, the website is ccdb.ws. That's a database of all the sightings this year. The photography is wonderful, and there's also archives of past years as well. Again, I remind people that are out there shooting shots with their cameras, especially their digital cameras. Your camera is capable of picking up fringe frequencies that we do not see in the ultraviolet and infrared range. Often things show up, and when the picture is put on your website or on your computer that you didn't see with your eye. So keep a close look. You might find a UFO there. And especially if you're shooting thunderstorms or around any kind of electrical activity, because UFOs seem to like that. A friend of mine who's a professional photographer showed me a shot recently. He took over a thunderstorm, and there was definitely an anomaly there that did not fit the scene in general, and he hadn't seen it when he was taking the photo, so it looked like very much like a UFO. The conference was taking place this weekend on UFO experiences and abductees. I wish them well and hope they had a good conference. It'll be over this afternoon. Today I'm going to continue with some of the audio from Richard Dolan that I played some last week as well. Richard Dolan is a respected ufologist, especially as a historian. He's written several books, and actually, I understand now he has a radio show of his own, which you can get on YouTube. So if you would like to know more about him or see more of his information or listen to him, his name is Richard Dolan. It's just D-O-L-A-N. Now, this first audio is quite interesting. This was audio that Dolan did during an interview with a man who called himself basically anonymous because he did not want to expose who he was because of what he had to say. Plus, it's known as a deathbed confessional because he was definitely in the process of possibly succumbing to a severe lung disease. So you will notice when he speaks, it's very difficult for him to talk, and it's almost kind of a whisper, so you'll have to listen closely. And he has information about exposing the whole extraterrestrial phenomenon to Eisenhower and Nixon. So I think you'll find this quite interesting. So I'll begin that now.
Yes, well, as we get older and older, I'm 77 right now. You can't live forever, you know. So if this procedure when they clean the blood doesn't work, then I've got probably a few more months to make it before my kidneys shut down. You know? So that's kind of why I'm kind of going along with the interview at this time.
You're seeing that what you went through is just too important for people not to know about.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you just... Can we start at the beginning with your military career and just walk through what exactly your experiences were?
I was in drafted into the military and got into the U.S. Army. After that, I was sent to the Signal Training Center in eastern United States.
What year would this be?
58. I went through the Signal Training course. And at that time, I went through the radio teletype course and also the cryptography course, crypto. They had five instructors that were getting out of military service. So they pulled the top five students, and I was third in the class, so I got pulled as an instructor.
Now, were you at this time also working yet for CIA?
No.
Not yet?
No. After one day, my boss came to me, and he said, how would you like to, you know, make some extra money? And I said, oh, money is good. So he explained to me that he could put it through, like, would I have to get a top secret White House Q clearance for the job, you know. And I thought, boy, must be a pretty exclusive thing, you know. And I said, well, what is this? And he said that I'm director for the CIA for Eastern United States, you know. And I said, oh, I didn't know that. And he said, you weren't supposed to. After about 6 weeks, my security clearance came through, and I got my CIA card. It was an ID card, like a credit card, where I could just go up to the door and slice it, walk right in, and my name at that time. I used an artificial name, too. Never used my real name. I started working with him on the project he was on. And that was Project Blue Book, which was kind of partially a fraud.
You're saying some of the Blue Book cases were, yes, were completely fictitious?
Yes. But the cases that we got came from, I think it was Fort Belleville, Maryland.
Mm-hmm. Fort Belvoir?
Yeah. And it didn't come from the Pentagon, or it didn't come from CIA headquarters. But we would get reports about a certain sighting that they had in Mexico or Italy or something like that. And then we would have to, we had people that would follow through on it, that would go out and interview the people to see if they were nut cases or if it was real, you know.
So they'd be going overseas frequently?
I wasn't, but I always stayed statewide. But the people we had working with us from the CIA would do that. We would get like a new report probably a couple times a week. I was coming into the Army fresh off the farm, you know, so I really didn't have much knowledge of anything. But my boss filled me in on Project Blue Book and what they had found so far, as far as Greys and aliens and the Roswell incident.
How did you feel when this first got dumped on you? When you first learned about this?
I was just kind of overwhelmed with all of this, you know. And I said to him, I don't know if I'm going to be able to be a judge of this type of thing. What's real, what's not, when I don't have much knowledge of it, you know. So
what did he say?
He said, well, we have to build the information as we go, and you'll see how this thing is working out.
And then the other thing is, of course, you really weren't able to tell family or close friends, obviously.
No, I couldn't tell anybody. In fact, I had to take a vow that I wouldn't tell anybody. A lot of it for 40 years, and more of it for 50 years, which is up in 2010.
You're doing all this crypto work. You're looking at images, photographs, video. It's 1958, maybe the fall of 58. What happened after this?
At that time, the Project Blue Book thing kind of went pot, you know. If you remember, back in those days, they kind of declared it as a nothing, you know.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And
they were telling the world all UFOs are misidentifications, hoaxes,
balloons,
psychological issues, whatever.
Yes.
Yeah.
So my boss came to me and he says, we've both got a new assignment. And he says, oh, I said, where are we going? Oh, he says, we're going to the Capitol. We're going to be part of the Eisenhower push. He's trying to find out something about, all about these aliens that MJ-12 was supposed to find out, but never sent back reports to him.
MJ-12, the UFO control group, were they calling it MJ-12 at that time?
Yes. They called us in, went into the Oval Office, and President Eisenhower was there, and Nixon, and they said, we called the people in from MJ-12, from Area 51 and S-4, but they told us that the government had no jurisdiction over what they were doing. So being a general, past general, you didn't tell them to go to hell without any a good reason, you know. Mm-hmm. So he said, I want you and your boss to fly out there. I want you to give him a personal message. And he says, I want you to tell them, whoever is in charge, tell them that to get in, they have this week, coming week, to get into Washington and to report to me. And if they don't, I'm going to get the First Army from Colorado, and we're going to go over, we're going to take the base over. I don't care what kind of classified material you got. We're going to rip this thing apart.
Eisenhower was going to invade
Area 51. Yeah, with the First Army.
So you go out with your superior.
Yes.
You fly out. You land. What happens? Can you describe this whole process? What you saw?
They took us the 13 or 15 miles south to S4 and like different garage door openings.
Okay.
And in these garage door openings, they had like different saucer crafts. The very first one had the Roswell craft in. It was kind of crashed up, but apparently every alien that was in it died except for a couple.
So you see the Roswell craft, and what are some of the others that you see?
Well, the Roswell craft was really strange because it looked like real heavy aluminum foil. We could rock next to it, and you could rock it. The whole thing probably weighed 150, 300 pounds.
Could they tell what the source of power was of this craft?
Yeah, it was like a reverse gravitational thing of some kind. In fact, one later on, I got the mathematical code for reversing gravity in a 3x5 card. I guess there are different types of grays and so on.
How did you see that evidence?
Well, at the later on at S4, we viewed the autopsy film, and then the colonel said, what we've got in here is we're interviewing a gray alien.
All right, right there. How did you feel at that moment?
Well, I thought, boy, we had no idea we were going to see the real thing. All we saw was film.
You had to have a little bit of heart racing
yes.
at that moment.
My boss was able to go in and add up like a partial interview with him.
So what did this gray alien look like? Could you describe him a little bit?
This one looked a little bit oriental.
So I'm just wondering, if it looked almost human, what about this didn't look human?
No, it didn't look human as far as the skin tone and basically the shape of it and the size.
How was its head size compared with a normal human, for example?
Brain was kind of a little bit bigger.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the nose was very, very small. And ears were just like holes. Mouth was very small.
Now, why were they bringing you out here at all, anyway, to see an alien? What was the point?
Go back and tell the president they actually had one.
So he did not know at this point
no.
if there was an alien
no.
at S4?
No.
What did you do then at Area? Were you done or did you have other things to do?
Yeah, so basically we were kind of done, went back to Area 51.
Mm-hmm.
They took us into the main building, and there we saw a U-2, which of course we didn't know existed.
Mm-hmm.
And the a model of the SR-71.
Yeah, the Blackbird.
So But like I mentioned earlier, it was not a model of the current Blackbird.
An earlier version.
But an early version.
Did you go directly to Washington after this?
Yes.
Or did you go somewhere else? How did they get, did you fly regular airline?
We flew back to the commuter plane back to the air base,
mm-hmm.
and then took President Eisenhower's Lockheed Electra back to Washington.
You and your supervisor,
yeah.
superior officer, and now you're meeting with the president?
Yes.
Can you describe this?
Well, we met with him in, the second story of the old OSS warehouse building. And Eisenhower and Nixon were there, and also Hoover was there. So he asked us what was going on, and we told him about the alien, the whole situation, and the black projects and so on, and he was just totally shocked. He appeared for the first time to be worried.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like he was worried.
I would think that Eisenhower would, I mean, he certainly knew that flying saucers were real.
Yes.
He knew that there were aliens. So I guess I'm just wondering, what would he have been, you know, really surprised about?
Surprised about the black programs. Eisenhower said, gotta keep this thing completely secret.
Mm-hmm.
You know, can't talk about this.
Your actual name is, I mean, the name you grew up with, that was a different name than what
yes,
you had in the...
I never used it in the CIA at all.
Now, what about today? You're going on the public record, and this is still sensitive information, even though earlier you talked about, you know, security oaths that maybe expire after a certain period of time.
50 years.
But you're still concerned.
Linda Moldenhauer's phone call, her phone was tapped, and they got my phone number, and through the telephone company, they're able to find me, and so on.
When they found you, what happened?
I was going to a grocery store. Two guys in black suits come out of a black Lincoln town car and came over to see me.
Mm-hmm.
And they told me that I better not publish anything or talk to Linda about any more things. So at that time, I did, you know, I stopped.
That was enough to intimidate you.
Yes. Rather remain anonymous. Never show my face on anything.
Really, thank you for doing this.
Yes. This was, I guess, kind of a good idea because I feel much better having talked about it.
Well, as you can tell, that was quite a trying interview for the man known as Anonymous, but very interesting information. And as you all probably well know, Eisenhower was known for his departing speech in which he talked about the dangers of the military-industrial complex, which could well mean he was speaking about these black operation programs that were hiding a lot of information about the UFOs and the extraterrestrials that they had under their watch. Interesting enough, there's a lot of rumor plus some interesting information on the internet by eyewitnesses that said that Eisenhower actually had a meeting with the ETs one evening at like 4 in the morning at Holloman Air Force Base in 1955. There was witnesses that saw Eisenhower's plane land, as well as two flying saucers landing at the end of a runway, and that Ike went out there and entered one of the saucers and apparently met with the occupants. Now, nothing ever came out what happened there, but it's an interesting story. Also, to Eisenhower, his great-granddaughter is very involved in the UFO disclosure, as well as trying to reveal a lot about these black programs that are going on, hiding the information. Also, during that period of time, there was a rumor that Nixon was very buddy-buddy with a comedian named Jackie Gleason, which all you older folks will know, but you younger folks won't. But he was very into the whole alien thing. In fact, he had a mansion that was built just like a UFO and lived there. But it's rumored that Nixon actually took Jackie Gleason and showed him the deceased bodies of some ETs. Okay, I'll take a moment to thank my sponsors, Diverse Landscapes here in Rockland, and Eric Best, who's an author and business consultant. I appreciate their support. This is WRFR 93.3 FM Rockland and 99.3 FM Camden, and streaming on WRFR.org. There's a link on that website for archives and podcasts of this show, as well as many other shows. So if you miss something, you can go back and hear it, which is a good deal. All right, this next audio is comments by Richard Dolan on the death of Neil Armstrong, because Neil Armstrong is the first man who walked on the moon, and who, after the event was over, was quite secretive about actually what happened. He was rarely interviewed, and if he was, he didn't say a whole lot. So this is Richard Dolan talking about Neil Armstrong, actually on the day that he died, that Neil Armstrong died. Okay, here we go.
So, Neil Armstrong, the first man on the moon, died today. He was 82 years old. I hadn't really heard much about Neil Armstrong in the last few months or year. I mean, he really had. He's one of these, one of the most enigmatic, reclusive icons of the 20th and 21st century, I would have to say. You know, it's one of the most odd things when you really think about this. The first man to walk on the moon. My mother, who is actually partying across the ocean right now with my sister, God bless her. But my mother always said to me, like when she was a girl growing up in the 1940s and 50s, that it was an absolute impossibility for human beings to make it to the moon. It was one of the biggest things that she always said to me. We always said it was impossible. No one could ever go there. I never believed it. And in fact, I know this. My mother did not believe that there would be a moon landing until she actually saw it on the television. And I remember the moon landing. I was 7 years old, but I remember it quite distinctly. I was at the house of my cousins in the little town of Levittown, New York, in a tiny little house. And there were, a lot of the family, extended family, was huddled around this pretty small TV. And I remember seeing it. I remember seeing Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin on the moon. And it was, even then, I was just old enough to realize that this was a really cool thing. But for members of the older generation, this had to be a mind-blowing thing. And here's the irony with Neil Armstrong. This man, it would be like he was the most famous man in the world and never, ever spoke to a soul practically about what he did. Who would have predicted that? What a bizarre thing. Well, of course, you have to wonder. I mean, there have been rumors and more rumors about things going on the moon. Now, I believe I mentioned either last week or sometime recently the conversation that I had some time ago, some years ago, with the scientist of remote viewing, Russell Targ, who told me that in the early 1980s he was charged for a while with overseeing training remote viewers whose job was to remote view the far side of the moon. And I said, really? Well, Russell, what were they going to be looking for? And there's a long pause. And he said, well, what do you think? I said, I don't know, E.T.? He said, yes. I said, did they find E.T.? He said, well, I don't know. That wasn't part of my mandate or my mission. Now, I happen to believe him. And if you've got remote viewers whose job is to be searching for E.T. on the far side of the moon, for God's sake, you got to wonder, what did the Apollo missions encounter when they were out there? I mean, really. I happen to believe that they went to the moon, but I do happen to believe, is my personal opinion, just based on certain leaks, and I'm going to talk to you about one of them in just a moment, but I happen to believe that they encountered things, and that this, more than anything else, accounts for the fact that so much of our Apollo heritage is just gone. A lot of these photographs, a lot of the transcripts, you know, they how could they not take care of this incredible legacy? So much is gone. Well, anyway, one of my collegial friends in this UFO business of ours is Timothy Good. I really liked him. He's not just a gentleman, which he is, but he's very rigorous at the same time that he pushes himself, and he's always struck me as someone who's unafraid to push the boundaries of where he has been in terms of his research. And, you know, because of his really superb book from the 1980s, Above Top Secret, which I am now holding in my hands, and which, in fact, was the first true UFO book that turned my head and got me involved in this. But Tim has always been in a position where he's been, like, people have come to him, which is what happens. You know, you become known, and then more people come to you. So Timothy Good mentioned in Above Top Secret, in fact, a very good friend of his who actually is now deceased. And, in fact, oh, man, I wish I could remember this or have thought to ask him. He gave the name of this person. It was a woman who was a very close friend of his. And, in fact, Tim told me part of this stuff privately. But this woman had a conversation with Neil Armstrong at a party, and or at some kind of gathering. And I actually want to read this to you, and I'm opening up my book here. He refers to her as a professor. She was a professor, as I recall. He writes, a certain professor whose name is known to me was engaged in an earnest discussion with Neil Armstrong during a NASA symposium. And according to my friend's recollection, part of the conversation went as follows. The professor, what really happened out there with Apollo 11? Armstrong, it was incredible. Of course, we had always known there was a possibility. The fact is, we were warned off. There was never any question then of a space station or a moon city. Professor says, how do you mean warned off? Armstrong, I can't go into details except to say that their ships were far superior to ours, both in size and technology. Boy, were they big and menacing. No, there is no question of a space station. The professor, but NASA has other missions after Apollo 11. Armstrong says, naturally, NASA was committed at that time and couldn't risk a panic on Earth, but it really was a quick scoop and back again. Timothy Good just concludes here, and he writes, later, when my friend confronted Armstrong, the latter confirmed that the story was true but refused to go into further detail beyond admitting that the CIA was behind the cover-up. And, you know, officially, of course, Neil Armstrong has never, ever given any credence to that story. But I will just say to you that, you know, not only did Timothy Good write about that in Above Top Secret, which is where I just read this from, but I did, again, I had the opportunity to speak to Tim privately. And he, you know, he stood by exactly what he said. And at that point that I had met with him, his the person who had told him that had recently passed away, and he had the name of her. And I, next time I I need to get that name. I want to have that written down anyway. Can ask him. But the point is that this, you know, I think this would explain very, very why, one reason why Neil Armstrong has not, never, ever said a word about this. And by the way, that's not the only source on Neil Armstrong. There is a NASA, high-level NASA officer, I'm trying to remember his exact position. His name was Maurice Chatelain. And Chatelain also confirmed that the Apollo 11 radio transmissions were interrupted several times in order to hide important, like these contacts, or to hide UFOs from the public. And I had the Chatelain quote in there. I just found it. He said that all Apollo and Gemini flights were followed, all of them, both at a distance, and sometimes, Chatelain says, also quite closely by space vehicles of extraterrestrial origin, flying saucers or UFOs, if you want to call them that. He said every time it occurred, the astronauts informed mission control, who then ordered absolute silence. He goes on to say, I think that Walter Schirra aboard Mercury 8 was the first of the astronauts to use the code name Santa Claus to indicate the presence of flying saucers next to space capsules.
Richie?
Yes, Rich.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but he was the chief of NASA's communication systems.
Oh, great, great. I had the information around here somewhere, and and here it is. I just found it on my own notes. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yeah, Maurice Chatelain wasn't just some guy. He was the former head of NASA communication systems. Had it was a very prominent position there. So you've got these statements that the astronauts encountered things out there. And, of course, you know, why would we be surprised that they wouldn't want to talk about it? So Neil Armstrong, for reasons that we can only speculate about, elected, like his colleagues, to be very, very tight-lipped about his experience. Unfortunately, I think it's, what a difficult situation to find yourself in. You know, could you imagine? You do this world famous, I mean, famous for the history of humanity thing, and in reality, your mental world is just so very different than what anyone else can conceive, and you just can't tell the world about what you have actually gone through. So that's Neil Armstrong, and 82 years old. Rest in peace. And it's sad. It's a sad story, in fact. I mean, why would you feel sad about someone who lived such a heroic life? But I do feel sad.
Well, that was kind of a interesting statement by Dolan about Armstrong. I mean, it really is true that probably the most famous man in the world hardly ever had an interview, and whenever he did have an interview, his information was just really general, nothing specific about what happened, which leaves a lot of room for rumor and innuendo. But I've heard the story about having been met up there by other beings many times before in different places. All right, this last audio is again Dolan, and it's again, he's speaking about a breakaway civilization, or actually speaking of what we would call the dark projects, or the projects that are hiding the UFO information, and actually are creating almost a parallel society to our own. So I'll go ahead and play that.
In today's world, for there to be a clandestine civilization that truly is separate in many important ways from, let's call it, the mainstream civilization of today, the civilization of iPhones and internet and financial connections and everything else. Is it possible that here on Earth there could be something that's different?
something that doesn't play with the regular, with the topside world, but that has its own situation going on. And I think the answer to that is yes, as counterintuitive as that might seem to you. And here's why I think it exists. It exists because of the UFO phenomenon. It exists because of something that interacted with our world that became known by our world roughly 70 years ago and was deemed so important, so transformative, that it had to be dealt with in absolute secrecy, at least for the time being. If you're Harry Truman and it's the 1940s and your top generals and intelligence officers and scientists tell you that we have recovered technology that does not originate from this civilization, you have a choice to tell or not to tell the world. I think your choice would be not to tell, whatever your initial proclivities might have been. And we can get into that reason at another time. I don't want to explore that right now. I want to explore what happens after that decision for secrecy is made. Because if you're going to study ET technology, clearly, right, you can't have Congress knowing about it. You can't have Congress funding it, at least not knowingly. Because Congress is not going to be able to keep the secret better than anyone else. It'll come out. And if it comes out, then the Soviets, the Russians know about it, the rest of the world knows about it, and then the next thing you know is you got to share this technology with the rest of the world, and you probably don't want to do that. To say nothing of dealing with the repercussions of possible social panic, and who knows what else, all the implications, energy implications, everything. So you keep it secret. You create a black budget system. You privatize that system. Because after all, if you want this technology replicated, you got to go to your private contractors. You got to Boeing and General Electric and Raytheon and General Dynamics and all those guys, those players. Who ends up owning the technology? Good question to ask. Is it private? Is it public? Pardon me. Some combination thereof? Whatever. It's clandestine. It's secret. Let's take it a step further still. After some years, some of your genius scientists working within that world have a variety of eureka moments, breakthrough moments, where they might have ideas that lead to improved transistors or integrated circuits, lasers, fiber optics. Take your pick. You're not going to find in the open literature references to ET technology, so, right, let's just go with this for a minute. They've got breakthroughs. That lowers their incentive for giving this secret up down to zero, down to less than zero, if you've got this great moneymaker. But let's take it even further still. Let's say that some breakthroughs involved really, truly radical endeavors, something that might involve revolutionary propulsion, what we might call anti-gravity in simplistic terms. Or a breakthrough in energy, something that could replace petroleum for all we know. Well, at that point, I think we can all see that the paymasters of that black budget, that black budget program would say, we're not going to take down the petroleum industry since we own the petroleum industry. So what you're going to continue to do is work on this privately, clandestine, secret. So the research continues, years, decades, generations. How far could they have gone on their own private trek, their own private trajectory ahead of the rest of our poor slobs working in the white world rather than the black world? Could they leapfrog or jump? Maybe leapfrog's not the right word. Could they just jump further and further ahead of us? Well, why not? How does science work? Breakthroughs lead to other breakthroughs, which lead yet to more breakthroughs. And if the rest of us have been denied access to a key breakthrough, then we will, of necessity, not reach subsequent breakthroughs. What I am suggesting is that this classified world made a breakthrough some time ago, and that breakthrough was in what we would call UFO technology, and that they have been using that technology for several decades, maybe for several generations, while the rest of our science has been effectively held hostage. Let's take it further still. This clandestine black budget world with access to, let's say, a functioning fleet of its own flying saucers is now able to do things that the rest of us can't do, such as leave Earth's atmosphere with ease, go out into space, go beyond Earth's atmosphere. Why not, really? Hey, guess what? We've had some very compelling leaks that have said exactly this. And I'm not talking about leaks by people who are just grandstanding for public attention. I'm talking about quiet leaks that came out really by accident. There is good reason to credit some of those leaks. In particular, I'm thinking of the 1988 ARV, Alien Reproduction Vehicle story by Brad Sorensen. I wrote about this in one of my books. You can look this one up on the web, I'm sure. So you've got this clandestine world that can do all kinds of things, explore all kinds of places that you and I can't readily do. Will they have encounters with these other beings that are part and parcel of the UFO phenomenon? I don't know. I can't say for sure, but I certainly think they'd have a better chance of doing so. Investigating the allegations of a base on the far side of the moon, for example. So they'd go there, they might encounter something, they might learn something, and then bam, there goes their worldview. The worldview that they grew up with, which is the worldview that you and I grew up with, goes shatter, gone, like a thousand shards of glass. And they have to recreate, pick up those pieces, and create a new worldview. I have to think that this is a psychologically stressful endeavor. I have to think that the world that those black budget individuals live in are psychologically highly stressful. But let's look at that as a civilization. They've got radically different technology. They have almost certainly a radically different worldview, a radically different cosmology that is a different picture of themselves in the universe, their place in the universe. Sure they do. Would that count as a separate civilization? One that has broken away, as it were, from our own, hence a breakaway civilization. And this is an idea that I've been working for a few years. I did develop this phrase and this idea in my second volume of History of UFOs in the National Security State. I expanded it, worked it quite a bit in AD After Disclosure, which I co-authored with my friend Bryce Zabel. And I've expanded on it and worked it a little more, still more, in my forthcoming lecture series and book that I talked about earlier in this show. It's an idea that just won't leave me alone. I think there's a lot to it. So, that's what a breakaway civilization is. Now, my working assumption is that it exists. It's real. I want to be careful about how I describe it. I don't want to say that I know it exists. I will tell you that I think it exists. I will furthermore tell you that I think I've communicated with some of its members. I don't know that I've communicated with its members. I think that I have. And maybe the day will come when I'll have more confidence about that. We'll just have to wait and see. I think that the day will come when I can give you a better answer one way or the other. Right now, I can't. Certainly, even if there isn't something as radical as what I'm envisioning, anyone who studies the U.S. classified infrastructure comes away recognizing that the layers of secrecy go deep, 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 deeper than deep. That, in other words, it's layer upon layer. If you're in the Navy and you're in this, you've been recruited into this program, they don't recruit you directly from your initial position. You get recruited by the Navy, maybe into the CIA or the NRO. And once you're in that world, you're a lifer. You can't really do anything else. You're there for good. Once you've worked for the NRO, you will never, ever be able to leave that type of milieu. You might be able to do an assignment at CIA, or you might get recruited to work in the deep black community that deals with UFO / ET. Let's call it Majestic. Who knows what they really call it? I think they might call it Majestic, even to this day. The point is that you tell your family, you tell your wife or your husband, going to work, honey. For all they know, you're going into the Navy facility that you've always gone to. But once you go there, you then punch another clock that might take you into the NRO work station that you may have for a little while. No one would know that, of course. And then even from there, you might go into the next layer, which would have you deal with the UFO / ET program. So there's multiple layers. And this isn't just rambling here. There have been some very good studies of individuals who have worked within that classified system who describe it exactly that way. I had a conversation with a scientist about, 8 years ago in his office. I've mentioned this story before. I'll just mention it briefly here because it's germane. This man was an associate friend, friendly acquaintance, let us say, of then-President Bill Clinton. A very exceedingly intelligent man, as you might imagine. A scientist. Very, very sharp man. He and I got along very, very well. And simply just said to me, in a very long 4-hour one-on-one meeting that I had with him, that at deeply clandestine levels, layer beyond layer of secrecy, that there are scientists who have in their possession alien technology and at least one body that he personally knew about. And those were his words to me.
Now remember that it sort of sounds incredible that that kind of secret could be kept, but remember that the Manhattan Project, which was the project for the atomic bomb, there was over 10,000 people that worked on that project, and it was never leaked out, as far as anybody knows, what was going on during that process. So even though it's a little bit hard to believe that there could be so much going on that we, the citizenry, don't know about, it has happened before. And I'll never forget Rumsfeld, when he was Secretary of Defense, in one of his press conferences, saying that they couldn't find $3 trillion that was part of the Defense Department. So this money gets siphoned off, and it would be really interesting to know where it goes. Okay, that's the show for tonight and this afternoon, I should say. And thank you for listening. More Dolan will probably be in the future, as well as other testimony from other people. And I appreciate you listening. And as usual, embrace the mystery. I will close out with the healing tape chant. Good night and have a good day.
Om Gandhim Pushti Vartanam.